What is the importance of truth? I grew up in a church that said, we have the truth. We are the truth. Rick, Mary, Ed, you grew up in a church that said, we have the truth. If you're with us, you've got the truth. Well, let's see what the Bible has to say about truth. If you would open them, I don't have this in the PowerPoint. Open your Bible to the Gospel of John. The Gospel of John. It's a New Testament book, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. John chapter 14 is where I want you to turn, and we'll see what the Bible has to say about truth. And this is Jesus who's speaking. Thomas had to ask him a question, and Jesus in John chapter 14, verse 6 said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So who is the truth? Is the truth something or is it someone? If we know the truth, we must be able to say we know Christ Jesus, if we're speaking in a biblical sense. When you go to court, you're supposed to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So help me God. They used to do that. They don't say the so help me God anymore. At least the last time I went in, I had to go into court for something, and they just said, you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? I hesitated because I was waiting for the so help me God. But they didn't say it, and I said, I do. And the truths that we have come straight from the Word of the Bible. You know, the Bible tells us that God hates a lie. He hates a lie. Because a lie is the opposite of the truth. Unique truths. What does unique mean? One of a kind. Something special, unlike anything else. Synonyms for unique are distinctive, distinct, special, rare, uncommon, unusual, once in a lifetime. Those things go along with the word unique. And I believe that God in His Word, the Bible, has truths that are available to everyone, but people, when they study the Bible, don't come up with the same reasoning. They don't come up with the same ideas. We saw a little bit of that in Sabbath school. We all have different ideas sometimes about certain things. Some things may really make a difference, and others may not make such a big difference. It might just be the way we look at a word or the way we look at something. But in this church and in other groups around the world, there are people who believe unique truths that separate them from the rest of Christianity, from the rest of the world, from all other religions, including Christianity, what people have come to know as Christianity. So we could say that we believe some unusual things when people hear us and talk to us about things. And before I get started on that, one of the things that Mr. Secord came yesterday and tuned our piano, and he said to me, I don't know why, but for the last week and a half to 2 weeks, something's really been on my mind. He said, the last time we talked about the Father and His Son. I'm on board. I believe that Christ is the literal Son of God. He gets it. He didn't quite know how to put it into words, but we went through a few scriptures and it sunk in just like that. He says, well, the one thing that I've had trouble with, he says, I grew up all of my life believing that the Holy Spirit is a third person. He said, but the more I study the Bible, the more I'm coming to the conclusion that this is not a third being. He said this to me yesterday, right here. I'd never talked to him about that. And I said, how did you come to that conclusion? He says, well, he says, in right here, and you see those Bibles are still sitting there. We had quite the Bible study. Right here in John 14, he says Jesus was talking to his disciples, if you're still there in John chapter 14. John 14. And he says here, let me find the verse. Here you go. Verse 15, 16. He says, I will pray the Father, and He will give you Another comforter, it says in the King James. Mine says another helper. The word comforter fits much better. I will give you another comforter that he may abide with you forever. And he says, you know, for some reason my eyes keep going to that word comforter. They keep going to that word comforter. He said that to me a couple of times. And I said, Mr. Secord, there's a reason for that. And I said, if you read this whole text, if you go through this, you'll notice what he says a little further down. He says in verse 18, I will not leave you comfortless. I was using the Authorized King James Version. And he looked at me and he said, Jesus is the comforter. And I said, amen. I literally almost started crying because he's such a special person to me. And he understands that Christ is the comforter, that it's Christ that comes to us, that it's Christ that's in us. This is a unique truth that the majority of Christianity completely overlooks because they've been taught all of their lives about this third being. This is one of the serious topics we're going to talk about this week in the upcoming series. And I want you to notice this verse here on the PowerPoint. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 9 and 10, it says, But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, who once were not a people, but are now the people of God, who had not obtained mercy, but have now obtained mercy. A special people. We could say a unique people, because special is another synonym for unique. And these are the people that God has chosen around the world. Not just this group. I'm not saying we are special, but he's given in his word a unique or special message. Are we availing ourselves to it? Are we listening to what it says? Are we reading it for what it says instead of what I want it to say? Or what I say it says. And if we do that, we are considered, there it says, the people of God, if we listen to what his word says. So there are some things that we do a little differently. When somebody asks me, well, what church do you go to? And I say, well, I go to the Prophecies of Hope Church. What denomination is that? Well, we're not considered really a denomination. We're a Bible-believing church. Well, what sets your church apart from others? I think I told you I had that conversation with someone not long ago. Well, where do you start? Where do you start in a conversation like that? How do you tell somebody, I paused for a minute, and I said, I think one of the things where we're different than a lot of Christians is we accept a literal interpretation of the Bible where we can accept it literally. In prophetic language, we understand there are some things that are symbolic. Would you say that's reasonable? I believe when it speaks of the creative days in Genesis, it's speaking in literal terms. But when it's speaking of the seed and the serpent, it's literal, but it's also symbolic of something much more than what it says in the text. So in prophetic language, things change a little bit. Christians, but overall, our interpretation of Scripture when speaking of the facts would be literal. We believe in the one true God, the God of the universe, Jehovah God. If you turn with me to Deuteronomy chapter 6, we've done this, we've read this many, many times. Deuteronomy, it's an Old Testament book, very close to the front of your Bible. Deuteronomy chapter 6. And I always, you know, sometimes less, when you say less, it's more. But sometimes things deserve an explanation. And when you look in my New King James Bible here, and you see in Deuteronomy chapter 6 and verse 4, before I read it, I always tell the people, this is considered to the Jewish people the most sacred text. They call it the Shema. Well, you know, for a Christian, when you mention a Jew, they pretty much will start to listen because they believe that the nation of Israel are God's chosen people. They were God's chosen people. And Israel is God's chosen people, but we're told in the New Testament that if you are Abraham's seed and you believe in Christ, then you are Abraham's seed, which makes you Israel, We've talked about this before. So I always make it clear that the Jewish people believe this is the most sacred text. And usually a Christian will tune in because they believe that the Jews today are God's people. So here in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4, if I use the tetragrammaton, the divine name, it would say, "Hear, O Israel, Jehovah our God, Jehovah is one." Jehovah is one. But when you show them this word Lord, I have to take them and I show them Psalm 110:1, which says, "The Lord said unto the Lord, sit at my right hand till I make thine enemies thy footstool." I show them the difference between the all caps and the capital and lowercase. These are the things we're covering in the series. And you say, "Wow, I've heard this 1,000 times. I heard this last year. I heard it the year before." You know, some of the things that we're covering for us, for those of us that are here, for those who tune in online every Sabbath, it's not new truth. There is no new truth. Jesus is the truth. Is he new? There's no new truth. It's our understanding has changed because we've studied the Word of God and we've come to know Christ better. It's new to us, but it's not new truth. We have more light because we're walking with Christ. So when I share these things with people, and it sounds like, "Wow, you've used that 1,000 times. You've used that illustration over and over and over." There are people who will be here who haven't heard it, who have never heard it. And they need to hear it. It's very important. So when I read a text like this and I take them to these texts and then I take them to Psalm 83, verse 18, we're going to do this in the series, the Psalms, and I show them that God has a name that is clearly portrayed in the authorized King James Bible. Psalm 83, 18, it says, "That men may know that thou, whose name alone is Jehovah, art the Most High over all the earth." That surprises a lot of people. It's not new to us. This is old news. We know this. Take this and make it a part of you. Memorize that verse and show people, because even in my Bible, well, actually, no, this the one that I'm carrying today doesn't have it. I have another New King James that has a little footnote next to the word Lord, and it takes you down to the bottom, and it says Yahweh, the divine name of God, otherwise known as Jehovah. It's removed from this Bible. That's sad. That's sad. Unique truth. Something special that most of the world doesn't have. We believe in the literal begotten Son of God. It's a beautiful, beautiful thing. It is understanding from my background. You see, there are so many different backgrounds here because I know Rick, Mary, and Ed, you came from the background that Christ was, you believed he was the Son of God, but somehow he was eternal with God. He never had a beginning. And maybe in your mind you thought, well, he has to have a beginning, but maybe you never argued it or thought about it or reasoned from the Bible on it. I came from a background where, yeah, he had a beginning. He was created just like Satan, Lucifer was created, but all things were created through him. So once you start to reason on these things and you take people to these texts and you show them, it becomes, I've never heard that. It becomes unique to them. This is something new to me. Why didn't my preacher tell me this? Why is this layman standing in front of me showing me things from the Bible that my paid pastor isn't showing me? We understand things like what happens when we die. We understand what happened in Genesis. Many people miss that. And they think that when we die, we're going to go to heaven or hell. And we know from the Psalms and from Ecclesiastes and from Proverbs and from Matthew, from the things Jesus said, from John, what happens. And it's very clear to us. We recognize that the spirit, when we die, returns to God, but that's not conscious awareness. In Ecclesiastes 12, verse 7. So, unique truths. Very unique things. We recognize, too, that hell is not burning now. For many people, you know, the simple question you can ask when you're witnessing to someone, they say, "Well, you know, I believe in eternal burning hell. I believe that the wicked are in hell burning." Well, wait a minute. Let's suppose we all know that Cain killed Abel. So most Christians would say, if Cain didn't repent, which if he didn't repent, he's worthy of hell. If he never repents, if we don't repent from our sins, we're worthy of hell, based on what the Bible says. So if Cain was thrown into this hellfire about 5,000 years ago for killing one man, does he deserve to burn 5,000 years longer than someone today who is a mass murderer that will die tomorrow? It just doesn't seem just. Doesn't seem fair. You see, our God is a just God. And when you show people that hellfire is not burning now, that it's just something that's going to burn, all of these unique truths, these are things that we know and understand that many don't. We recognize that there's a sanctuary in heaven. I still need to study that more. I hope we do that soon in Sabbath School. I'd like to do that again. Maybe after we get through with our next study we're going to do. I think, what was your next topic, Ed? Daniel, after we finish with the book of Daniel? Maybe we can do the sanctuary. I don't want to make that decision, but I think it's something that I need to be more up to speed on. But recognizing that there was a literal sanctuary in heaven and that the pattern that was here on the earth represented the one in heaven and what takes place there and what is taking place now, most Christians just completely miss that idea. All of my life, I miss the fact that I would meet Jesus face to face, that I would meet our Heavenly Father face to face, that I would never see them. That's what I was taught. I would never see them. But as I've studied the Bible, I've come to learn these truths. Now, I think most Christians believe that they would meet the Father and the Son. I think most believe that. But understanding how it happens, what gets us there. Even the diet, you know, the diet's very important. And one of the things that I don't think we've ever talked about, but I'm sure Ed's going to talk about this when we do Daniel, is diet was very important to Daniel and the Hebrews. And, they were supposed to go forth and eat certain things that the king had, King Nebuchadnezzar being a Babylonian king, and they knew that this was against God's law. They weren't supposed to take these things in. These things were not supposed to enter the human body. And so I'm not going to steal Ed's thunder. When we do Daniel chapter 1, it's real interesting what happens there. Because some of us may not, I'm not sure if all of us have been through the first chapter of Daniel. We kind of skipped that in the series to get right to the meat of Bible prophecy. But it's really interesting what takes place there. Understanding the Antichrist and the mark of the beast. And you say, you know, does this really matter? Is it really that important? And then when you show people what their churches have always taught in the past, what the reformers, the ones who actually started their church, teach some of the very things that we're going to be presenting. And when they see that, it can be offensive sometimes. It can be very offensive. So the gift of understanding the prophetic message is very important. The gift of prophecy. Unique truths. You know, we've talked about this in Sabbath School. I did a little, and I don't think I ever finished it, and I'm not going to finish it now, but we did a little presentation during Sabbath School several months ago, and I listed seven S's that kind of set us apart from most of Christianity, not all of them, but most of them. And I just want to share some of those with you. The seven S's. And here's one of them right here, the Son of God. I'll ask any Christian at any time, who is the Son of God? And they'll say, well, Jesus. Well, how is he a Son of God? And, you know, I asked Mr. Secord that, but he knew. But when you ask certain people that, they'll say, well, he's a Son of God because he was born of Mary about 2,000 years ago. And I'd say, well, in my mind, that makes him the Son of Man. But when did he become the Son of God? You see, we have something unique there that most of Christianity misses. He is the Son of God from the time he came forth from the Father in eternity past, whenever that was. A unique truth, one of the seven S's, Son of God. Another one is the Sabbath. What a marvelous thing the Sabbath is. And I know, you know, for me, when I first started keeping it, it was very difficult, and it's hard when you don't do this, you haven't done this all of your life. It can be very difficult to adjust our lives. It's hard to adjust our lives to understanding that Jesus is the literal Son when we've had something in our mind all of our lives. Sometimes those old beliefs come back to us. They come back in our minds, and we catch ourselves, oh, wait, no, that's not how I want to say that. I've done that several times. Well, the Sabbath is a blessing. It's been from the beginning of humanity, from the beginning of time. God created the Sabbath. It was there when Adam and Eve were there. In fact, they were created on the sixth day, right? And on the seventh day, their second day of life, they spent it with Jehovah right there in the garden. They were together. First Sabbath together with man. God spent it with man right there in the garden, right after he had made it holy. It's beautiful. Another one of the seven S's is the state of the dead. Understanding what happens when we die is so important. Because if you're misled on this topic, then we can't truly understand what happened to Christ when he was crucified, when he died for humanity. Because so many people don't believe that he really died. Even in people who understand what happens when we die, they'll claim, well, he didn't really die. Isn't that true? And there are those who believe that when Christ died, he went into hell and preached to the souls of those who had sinned. So this state of the dead, this is a very important topic, understanding it and knowing it. We're going to drive that home during the series. One of the other S's is the state of health. Now, we've touched on this in the Bible Prophecy series in the past. We're not doing it this time, but understanding the biblical diet. If we follow God's laws, you're going to live longer. You're going to be healthier. That's just all there is to it. Your life will be better. It's always good. State of health. And so many denominations, churches, Christians, they believe, I can eat anything I want, anytime I want. Isn't this the attitude of the whole world today? I can do what I want. I don't have to worry about what anybody thinks. I can infringe on the rights of anybody else. And that means if I can do what I want, and I can go to church when I want, I don't have to go to church if I want, I can sleep around anytime I want, I can go out with anybody I want, well then, I can eat anything I want. It's a selfish world. Son of God, Sabbath, state of the dead, state of health. This is all biblical. Number five, the sanctuary. We touched on that just a moment ago. Understanding the sanctuary. And then when we get to the New Testament and we see that we are where Christ can dwell in this temple, or we could call it a sanctuary, couldn't we? And then the sixth one is the spirit of prophecy, understanding and knowing prophecy, but it goes further than that. I don't know if I've ever used this term from the front here, but God has given a gift to his people in the prophetic message. And maybe as time goes on during Sabbath school, during our studies on Wednesday nights, these are some of the things we can address. Because the spirit of prophecy is something that you don't just blurt out to people that are new, because it's a gift that was given to God's people. And it doesn't mean that anybody here is a prophet. That's not what we're talking about. And it's a beautiful thing. But I will say that because God has given his people this gift of the spirit of prophecy, that when we look at these Bible prophecies, the understanding is crystal clear. Wouldn't you agree? And if we let the Bible interpret itself, and we know what it says, and we know what these prophetic messages mean, it makes our lives so much more meaningful now, today. And the last one, and certainly not least, is the second coming of Christ. How he comes. We don't know when, we don't know the day or the hour, but we know it's sooner now than it was when I began this sermon. Isn't that true? His coming is getting closer and closer. And how he comes. All of my life I was taught it was an invisible presence. I do believe Christ has an invisible presence. That's his spirit. But the second coming of Christ, when Christ comes again, He comes in the clouds and will be caught up to meet him in the air if we're among the righteous. And you know, the messages that we're showing here, the Son of God, it's not popular because it's different than what people have traditionally been taught. The Sabbath, it's not popular because it's different than what people have traditionally been taught. The state of the dead, it's not a popular message. Why? Because it's different than what most churches teach. The state of health, not popular. The sanctuary, not popular. The spirit of prophecy, some would say it's heretical, wouldn't they? They'd say you're a heretic. And the second coming. I think that the majority of Christians are on the same page with the second coming. But now in the last 50 years or so, there's developed another doctrine that has adulterated the second coming, saying, well, there's going to be this tribulation of a period of time of 7 years. You see, so Satan's constantly working, constantly trying to put it in the minds of people, things that aren't in line with the Bible. But if we stick with Scripture, we're going to know and understand these things. I'm sure there's many more. But I believe that these specific topics separate God's people, Bible-believing Christians, not a denomination, those who trust the Bible. If you study His Word, I believe you will come to understand these seven S's. And, you know, it's funny because I was asked by, Mr. Secord asked me the other day, he says, you know, the church that you were in, didn't they have their own Bible? And I said, well, they have their own translation, yes. I said, but you know, the truths that I have learned, I was using that Bible when I came to the understanding and I realized I had to leave that church. So whatever translation of the Bible you use, if you're truly seeking truth, God will make sure you get the message He wants you to get. And it's vital that we keep studying. It's vital that we keep that going. And again, I just want to remind you that, you know, the things that are in the series, you may have heard some of them before. I might use a few different illustrations. You might say, wow, that's exactly what he said a few years ago when he did this similar series. But how many times have you, I hate to use this illustration, but we've all done it. We've all watched a movie. We have all watched a movie. And you see it the first time and you think, wow, that was a really good movie. And then you see it again and you say, I didn't see that the first time I saw it. And some people will go back again and again and again because they like the movie and they might even know some of the dialogue. But then something happens, they say, I don't remember seeing that the other 10 times I saw it. So it's good to go over these things. You know, we could read the Bible. I know a man who, he's in his 80s. He's a customer of mine. And ever since he was in his mid-20s, he's read the Bible from start to finish. Every year, he does it. All through, every year, he has a program. And he goes from the beginning to the end. And he says, there has never been a time, even right in Genesis, when I'm starting in the first few days, that I don't see something that I didn't see the other 60 times I've read it. 60 times! 60 times he's read the Bible, through and through. And it's hard today to get somebody to read it once. It really is. So the other thing is, one of the reasons why we do this over and over, and I invite the people back over and over, is because lives change. You know, I'm willing to bet, and I don't bet, that the gentlemen that were across the street are thinking differently today than they were before last Monday, before they were arrested. I'll bet you their thought patterns are different. Maybe not, but usually when you're in a situation where your life has changed and, wow, this is a life-changing incident, now I'm going to pay for this for maybe 10 or 15 or 20 years, you start thinking differently. Isn't that true? Well, maybe somebody that you have invited before and they've come before, maybe they never wanted to come before, maybe something's happened there in their life. There's a tragedy that now they're starting to think, well, you know, I need some kind of direction because things have changed in my life. So this is why we keep going over it and over it and over it. Because things have changed in my life in the past year to where I see things in the Bible that I didn't see a year ago. There's always something we can learn. So let's turn our Bibles to Luke, closing text, Luke chapter 10. This was our scripture reading for today. Luke chapter 10. and verse 1. It says in Luke 10, verse 1, after these things, the Lord, that's Jesus, appointed 70 others also, and sent them two by two before his face into every city and every place where he himself was about to go. And he said to them, the harvest is truly great, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Go your way. Behold, I send you out as lambs among wolves. The message may not be popular. You might be told, when you knock on somebody's door, if you want to hand them a handbill, you might be told, I'm not interested. Okay, well, have a nice day. And just walk away. But you know, next year when we do a series, they might be interested. The person that wasn't interested yesterday might be interested today. Isn't that true? That happens in my life constantly. Well, I wasn't really interested in that. But boy, once it hits you, now suddenly, okay, I've got a question about this. I never worried about it before, but now I want to know. And that's when you've got their attention. So unique truths, they're all right here. They're there for anybody. It's just, will you accept it or not?